afternoon, everybody. I'm just waiting for 1:30. Waiting till then to actually begin. I'm trying a different area in my house today, hoping that my art will be more visible at the same time. I'm still waiting for an actual tripod so that I can set things up a little better so that you can watch what I'm doing as I'm doing it. For now, I've had to make do, and I'm hoping that this will be a little bit better than our past video sessions. So, hoping to see a few of you today. For those of you were with us on Monday night, we were creating this mandala tree, or mandala tree, whichever you like to pronounce mandala. So I just, for those of you who have made a tree like this already, I recommend going a bit further with it, and just in anticipation of spring, just place some spring buds. So taking a little green of some watercolor or some pencil or felt, and just placing little buds along the branches, just in anticipation as we wait for those of us who are here in Edmonton who don't have leafy trees yet, we don't have any leaves or even buds on our trees yet, as we wait for spring in great anticipation, we can place some little buds on our mandalas, and then when we begin to see more leaves, we could add leaves, and then we can add blooms, and then fruit, and carry on as we begin to see the different seasons, and we can continue using the same mandala that we used that has permanent ink, and go through the different seasons. We can add the green buds, and then we can add the green leaves, and then we can add the blooms and the fruit. And then as we move into fall, we could even add fall leaves. So it's just sort of a little mindful practice as we go through the different seasons. So I've been just trying to scroll on my computer to see if I can see the video live on my computer. Since you're further away, I've got my glasses on, and I still am not sure I can see if anyone's watching. Oh, it looks like a few of you are watching. Hi, nice to see you. Thank you for tuning in today. So today we've been focusing on the mandala as a mindful art practice. Creating the mandala can just be a nice, easy way to have a mindful practice, because it's an easy way to engage in present moment awareness just by engaging in the artwork and creating this circular design. It's also just a great way to be non-judgmental in this awareness, because a mandala is easy, a circular design like that is easy to design, and it doesn't require a lot of skill huge skill. It takes some skill, but you can't really make a mistake with it. It's just a nice, pleasing way to create a design, and it's just an enjoyable way to spend some time in a mindful practice. So we're going to carry on with a mandala work again today. And I'm just going to say hi, Doug. Hi, Richard. Good to see you. Thank you for tuning in. So as I said, I've moved into a different area in my home so that I can more easily share with you my work as I'm working on it. So I'm just going to swipe right so that I can see my full screen so that I know what you can see. And like I said, I've got my glasses on because you're much further away from me now, but you can see my journal, and you can see my tabletop, my little miniature tabletop, and some of my art supplies, and know what I'm doing a little bit easier than when I'm kind of working on it and showing you and then working on it some more. So I hope this is going to be helpful for today's work. But before I do this, before we get started with the art making, and while we're waiting for a few more people, I'm still trying to find, scrolling down on my laptop to see if I can find our video live on my laptop, and so I'll just continue giving that a try, but nope, doesn't seem to show up here. So I guess what I'm going to do is hope that I can just check on your comments here and there so that I can have a dialogue with you once in a while during our video live stream today. What I wanted to begin with, as I did on Monday night, was just a reading from this book called Embers. It's just a really great, I find it to be a meaningful book of meditation, so I thought I would share it. And we're going to be working with lights and darks that form light source and shadow and create the form of a shape and create a more of a 3D effect. It's called chiaroscuro. So I'll be talking to you more about that later. But because of our discussion about light and dark and how they're both necessary to create form in drawing, I just wanted to share a meditation about light and dark that Richard Wagamese talks about. And again, Richard Wagamese is one of Canada's foremost First Nations authors. He was one of the great writers of our time, and so I highly recommend this book if you don't already have it. Like, I know some of you have shared that you have it and really enjoy it. So we'll take a few moments to just take some deep breaths and just relax, get comfortable. And I'm just going to begin the reading. So, watching morning break, I realize again that darkness doesn't kill the light. It defines it. I believe that now. For years, I didn't. I believe that I was my failures, mistakes, misjudgments, shortcomings, and wrongs. But I'm not those things. I am the light that shines from my faith, my courage, my willingness to be vulnerable, and to be responsible and accountable. Moments of darkness only highlight that truth these days. I'm moving beyond it. I'm basking in the light of my own recovery and the brilliance that comes from allowing myself to be seen as I am, warts and all. I'm not just those warts either. I'm the frog who wears them, gradually becoming a prince. So these are the thoughts of Richard Wagamese and his meditation on light and darkness, and how both of them are part of our lives every day, and both of them can create the wholeness of form, and I think also the wholeness of our becoming who we truly are once we accept everything about ourselves, in our past difficulties, and maybe some of our difficulties that we're going through right now. Just really accepting that as a part of all of who we are. So as we move into our mandalas, that could be a part of our meditation. It's just about wholeness, because that is really what mandalas are about. They're about the wholeness of who we are as we organize lights and darks and organize inner chaos, if you will, and just become more in tune with that as we kind of meditate on it abstractly as we create a mandala. So I hope everybody's hearing me okay. I'm just going to do a little check-in to see who's here and who's watching, who might be commenting, and I'm not seeing anything yet. So if you would like, I invite you to make comments, and please let me know if you're having any troubles hearing me, or if you have any questions, or you're not clear on what I'm talking about, or if you'd like to know anything more. Just love to open up the conversation and have a dialogue. So please know that you're welcome, and thank you for being here. So I thought for a quick mandala to start with is a mandala with watercolors, and a technique I really enjoy myself as a meditative practice is called wet on wet technique. It's also known as watercolor, water with color into water. So wet on wet or color into water. So I'm just going to show. It's easier to show and demonstrate than it is to explain. So this is what I'm going to do. So the first part of this is to just add water to the circle. The circle that I have penciled in with a Tupperware container, I first penciled in the circle. And I'm now adding water. So this is something that is a very quick approach, because you want to the water to stay and you want the page to be very wet as you add color, so that the color will disperse into the paint properly. So I've covered my circle completely with water for this wet on wet technique. So I'm going to add color to the water, and just with a very mindful approach with these watercolors that I have that are happen to be on circles templates for the different color palettes. I'm just going to add some color. So I want to get my paintbrush fairly full of the paint as I apply it to the water that is already on the surface of the paper. And then just allow it to disperse into the water as I move it around on the page with my brush. So it looks like you can see what I've done, but I'll just lift it up a bit. So I've added some paint to my watercolor. Now I'm going to change colors. What's important with colors is you want to keep it fairly monochromatic. Sorry, I got a call. I'm going to add some other colors. This orange. Has a nice effect with the pink, purpley color. And I'm going to add some, add some more purples. And you'll notice the watercolor is not going to go beyond where I've put the water. So that's another interesting part of the effect. And so I just mindfully just adding color arbitrarily to my mandala to see what happens. As I continue to do it, and this would be nice to do, to put some music on and just add to the meditative quality of the moment. Okay. I like the dark blue streaks, so I'm going to add some more of that just because it has a nice contrast to the rest of the paint. So I hope you have some watercolor paint and a brush and some watercolor paper. That is also really important to have the right kind of paper in order to do this technique, so that the paper stays nice and flat. Otherwise, the water, as you place the water onto the paper, the water will get really rippled, and then you won't have the same ability to have control in where you put in the colors. So there you go. That is a wet-on-wet color technique to create a mandala in a sort of a mindful process. So I hope you have some time, or maybe even right now, to try that process. So we're going to move on to my main idea that I have for you to explore today. And it's called chiaroscuro. So this is what I have, and I know it's probably backwards. So I'll just take a photo of it and post it on Facebook. Many of you may be familiar with it. It's a word, it's an Italian word that combines the words of light and dark, and it's really the treatment of light and dark when you're shading in a drawing or a painting to create a 3D effect of the form. So it's interesting that the light and the shadow are equally important when you're creating the whole form, the whole shape. So what we're going to do today with this chiaroscuro idea is we're going to just create a mandala or a circle drawing once more. So I'm going to create a couple. I'm just going to take the lid of my watercolors, and I'm just going to draw circular shape. So right now it's just a pencil line drawing of a circle, but we're going to take it from this circular line drawing of a circle, and we're going to create a 3D sphere from this by creating a light source on the object, and then shading it and adding a shadow beneath it that creates the look of three-dimensional form. So the first thing is to decide where your light source is going to be on your object, when in this case it's a circle that is going to become a sphere. But if you wanted to try it in other sketches, you could sketch a vase, for example, and just do the contour drawing of the shape with a pencil, and then begin to give it form and definition by doing this chiaroscuro, a light and dark drawing and shading. You'll eventually give it a more 3D effect. So this was developed, and the term was given to it by the Renaissance artists. And so, like, if you look at Rembrandt, Leonardo da Vinci's paintings, you'll see how there is a great contrast between light, very light parts of the paintings compared to the very darkest parts of the paintings, which typically in the Renaissance period were completely dark in the background. So for my circle that's going to become a sphere, I have decided that my light source is going to be coming in from here. And so that is going to be the lightest part of my sphere. And the darkest part is going to be the bottom, bottom right. And then the shadow is going to be underneath the bottom right. And I'm just going to roughly sketch in what I would think would be the shape of the shadow underneath. And roughly sketch in where my light source is on my sphere. So that I've decided my light source is at the top left of my circle, and the shadow is on the bottom right, and it's the opposite from where you are looking, but I will eventually post this on Facebook so that you can see it in reverse. So the most important thing to do, and one main reason why I've chosen my light source on this side of my sphere, is because I'm right-handed, and so most of my drawing and shading will be on the right side of the sphere, and so I have less chance of getting it all smudged with my hand as I work from light to dark. So I'm just going to begin by just sketching in the area around the sphere at the to the left of the sphere. Just so that having some definition of the space around it will help also to give it form. So this is just going to be really dark. And so I'm working from dark to light, shading this left-hand corner, upper corner beside the sphere. And then I would eventually shade it, keep continuing to shade it as I bring it around the sphere, but it will get lighter and lighter as I take the shape. So then I'll move into the, I'm just going to darken in really close to the edge of the circle to just continue to give it some definition in the space. I'm just going to finish that and quickly show you up close. That's it so far. So I'm using 4B drawing pencil, which is a very soft lead, which allows me to go really dark in the dark areas and then also work to the light in the lighter areas. So I'll show you what I mean. And for some of you, this could be really basic stuff. I hope you bear with me and just enjoy the simplicity of it. For others of you, this might be the first time that you're doing such a this specific kind of drawing, this chiaroscuro technique, that gives the 3D shape. So I'm kind of finding sort of a medium tone to start with on the edge of my sphere. So it already begins to show a contrast between the space around it and the shape itself. Now I'm going to begin to make it lighter and lighter as it goes to the center of the sphere. process of shading your drawing, working from dark to light. So you just practice moving along and making it lighter and lighter as we move into this part of the circle. That's going to be the lightest part. And then we're going to establish the lightest part of the sphere. So I've got some shading of medium tones from medium light to light now, and I've kind of just about come to the halfway point of the drawing of the sphere, so I'll just show you up close again. That's how it's come along so far. And the interesting, important thing about creating the chiaroscuro effect and having a light source and having shading from dark to light to dark again, it's really important to have a focus point, and so a localized sort of highlight area, and so that's when a kneadable eraser or just a really clean eraser, even of the tip of your pencil, might work. I really enjoy using kneadable eraser because it just seems to me to be, it's the most effective, and it's what I learned to use. So I'm just going to create the highlight, the center of my sphere. So really what it's doing is moving it removing the shading in one focus spot to give it the effect that it's a highlighted area. And I'm just going to shade in a little bit because I've got a little bit too dark. And so I'm just going to shade around this focal point. So I hope some of you are enjoying drawing this with me right now, and I'm sorry I can't see any of your comments. I think maybe I'll just take a second to check and see if there's any comments or questions. I see there's a few more of you watching. Hello, everybody. Thank you for being here. And if you can make some comments and I don't see them right away, immediately, I will definitely make sure to reply to comments after the video, the live stream video. I'm also going to just check on my laptop here. And see if I can find the video online. I would really love to know if you can all hear me properly and if I'm projecting my voice enough, and if you're finding that this is working by me drawing in front of you. Hope it's easy to see. And I'm not finding the video, live video on my screen. But it looks like others of you are, so that's good. So I'm going to continue working on my sphere. I have this focal point where there's the highlight that I've used an eraser to create. So that's the highlight of the sphere. And so I'm also using this kind of as a meditative exercise, just because it's just kind of calming to sit here and sketch with a pencil and simply create from a simple pencil line drawing of a circle, begin to create a sphere. To shade sort of to the curve of the circle. Because that adds to taking on the form, the 3D sort of form of the sphere. So my shading In my shading, I'm attempting to do that. And so it's good to just go back and forth as you begin to kind of sketch out and kind of feel out which is the darkest and which is the lightest part of your sphere. So now I'm going to begin to shade this other side. And so I'm going to be getting darker and darker with it. And as I begin to create a darker shades on this side, the lighter shades will show up as more prominent and to give sort of the optical illusion of a 3D form. So it's really interesting, the play of lights and darks on the surface of just a flat surface to create an illusion of the three-dimensional surface. And it's kind of fun to see how this happens as you draw. And so I hope you're enjoying this as well. Eventually, you could create a little core in the middle of it, and it could become an orange or an apple. But for now, it's just simply a pencil drawing of a sphere. So it takes time to create this drawing. And that's why I thought it would be a nice kind of mindful, relaxing process. So as I'm finishing up this sphere, I'm gonna just turn on a little bit of music. Sorry that I'm not seeing your comments today. I'll try and figure out what I can do to just improve on this so that we can have a dialogue going again. In the meantime, I'm just going to play music while I finish this sphere drawing. My light's already established on the one side of the sphere, with the dark and that is in the space around it. Now I'm just going to finish the darks on the other side to create the shade, which then allows for the form to take shape. And then the last thing I'll be doing is the shadow underneath the sphere to put it in place. So as we have a shadow on the bottom of it, as you see, I've sketched in, just with a pencil line, I've sketched in where I would put the shadow. And so you want to sketch that in, and that will be our last part of the drawing that we'll shade in. For this, I was thinking about how it's the light and darks that are necessary to show the form of the 3D form of the shape, to make it more three-dimensional. It's kind of a metaphor for how the lights and darks, lightness and darkness and life, are both part of life and both essential. Understanding the wholeness of life. And it's quite common for people to refer to dark times as bad times, but really dark times can be the greatest times of growth. You think of the top of the mountain, there's really no growth in a lot of mountain areas, and the greatest growth are in the valleys. And when you think of growth of each tree or any kind of vegetation, there's so much growth that goes on in the darkness and the depth of the dark soil where there is no light for a long time. And even in our human life, there's complete darkness in our earliest part of our life when we're just being formed in the womb. So I was just kind of thinking of how essential darkness is as a part of life. As it is, as is light, we all move towards the light, and light is also such a great metaphor. When we're in a dark room and we light a candle, it's that one candle can just take over, and the room is no longer completely dark. So those are just some thoughts that I would add to this drawing of light and dark to create the form of a sphere. I was remembering too that one day when a bird flew into my garage. I was doing yard work and I had my garage door open, and I wasn't sure what to do because this poor bird had flown into my garage. How was I going to would get out of my garage so that I could close it for the day. But then I thought, what if I close the main door of the garage and I open the small door? Because I noticed that when the garage is closed and there's no light on, it's really dark. But the smaller door is very focused on a bright day. It's a very focused, bright light. And so it was interesting for me that when I did that, I closed the main door of the garage and opened the smaller door. The bird did find its way out through the brightness of the light of the smaller focused area of prominent light. So I just thought I'd share that little bit of a story about dark and light. So I'm just going to continue working on my sphere. This is how far I got again. I'll just show it up to you really close up. So now I'm going to get really dark at this bottom part of the sphere. Go back into the other shading just to keep the shading more graduated from light to dark. Continue going back and forth to create even toning. So it takes some time and some patience, but eventually you create this 3D effect and what was originally just a circle, pencil line, simple pencil line of a circle becomes a sphere. Takes on the look of a sphere in the 3D. So this is a technique that goes back to the Renaissance, the 1500s. So we're talking a very age-old tradition in drawing and painting. I don't know if it's really taught anymore. Probably in some very basic drawing courses like the one I took, that I learned this chiaroscuro effect that I've taken into many drawings since. So to apply this further, it's fun to like take simple shapes such as a vase or grouping of a plate of fruit, or even just a grouping of rocks, and sketch the outline of the shapes as you did with the circle, and then take that shape shadows are, and keeping it consistent as you add other objects to the drawing. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now I've finished the sphere. Hopefully it looks like a sphere, a ball, I guess. I'm just going to go in and carefully detail the very edge. Dark shading. Okay, so there you go. That is the sphere. Go in and do the shadow. So I have the shadow sketched in lightly. You want to make sure that it's right underneath, directly underneath the light source, so that it has a nice, nice little diameter along the bottom. I'm going to darken in the shape. And as I'm creating the shadow, I'm going to start from the furthest out the edge of the shadow that is furthest away from the object. Along the edge. Because as the light source is hitting the object and then the shadow is hidden from the light source, then the light is again really bright beyond the shadow. Just going to create a little tabletop horizon line. And it's good to just turn your drawing around back and forth and avoid smudging your drawing with your hand. Shadow. Okay, how's everyone doing? Just gonna move these things out of the way, give myself a little extra room. This is probably sort of a medium tone or shade against the darker shade of the sphere, the bottom of the sphere, so that that bottom part of the shape won't get lost in the shadow. So it's important to have a contrast there as much as anywhere. So there is, in fact, in a shadow, there is a lighter part of the shadow and there's a darker part of the shadow. And the darkest part of the shadow tends to be right at, towards, around the edges of the shadow, right before you step into, imagine being in the shadows, right before you step into the light is the darkest part of the shadow. So that's kind of interesting. Good just to take a look at it from a distance and see what it needs. And I'm thinking that my shadow definitely needs to get darker, but that's how it's looking so far. Careful when I'm shading that I don't get too dark too quickly either, because it can get too dark and lose the sort of the graduated form, shades of gray. So this is what you could call this, shades of gray that the form from lights to darks. Now I'm just going to create some shading in the space around this back, this darker part of the sphere. That again is lighter than the sphere itself, but still showing that there is some space. Continuing to go lighter and lighter into the space and just allowing it to just eventually just completely diminish at the corner of this space, the drawing, the page. to always keep the back, the space around the shape, separate and in contrast to the shape itself. I'm just about finished. I hope you've found this fun and informative, and I look forward to hearing your responses, seeing your responses, reading your responses, and seeing your artwork as you choose to share and post. And I want to thank you again for posting your drawings and artwork online and with me via email. It's really so nice to just be connecting right now in this time when we're physically isolated from one another. It's just another way to connect in a creative way. I'm finding that this is something that has really been important for me, and so I thank each of you for participating in this and making this meaningful, and I hope you're finding that it's been meaningful and valuable to you. Looks like you had a minute of disconnect, so sorry about that. I'm just finishing up. And that's it. That is my drawing of a sphere and the surroundings that it's in on a tabletop, I guess you could say. And I invite you to try it out, see how you do with it, and create as it in a sort of a mindful process, allowing yourself to relax into it and just take your time to focus and engage, experiment. Have a learner's, a beginning kind of mindset. I'm just beginning, I'm just learning. It doesn't matter how it turns out, I'm just giving it a try. Or I've done this before, I'm just gonna take a moment and give it a try today and see how I do with it today. So thank you again for joining me, and awesome day and an awesome week, and we'll see you again on Monday night. Bye.